All right. Hi, nice to be here. It's been so many smart cats this morning. It's almost making me a bit nervous. Seeing all the other talks, I think this is a great moment to start out saying we're hiring at Beepsend. If any of the speakers feel like they need a new job, I think you should come to us because we would love to have you. It's also hard to follow up someone whose last name is Ninja. But I'm going to give it a try. I'll talk about 12 insights, or as far as we can get through 12 insights about what makes Agile API. When I got the request to talk about platform's agility, I immediately was thinking about my dog, because I do train agility with her. And I didn't quite know how to transform the dog training into API talks. But here's my take on it. So my name is Christian, and I work as CTO for Beepsend. We are an aggregator of SMS. Basically, we're a phone operator, a network operator. We have some base station equipment, and we do signaling. Our job was to simplify the way that you could send messages from the internet to your phone without using IP. So we spent a few years building infrastructure, and today we're spending another few years just making the APIs and make it more accessible for companies to use. As such, we did learn and we took a few cues about what it means to be agile as a company. First off, what are the definitions of agile and API? I think everyone seems to have their take on it, and everyone agrees, which is a really interesting and very pacifist way of approaching problems. We're all right, though everyone kind of says different things. I think that's beautiful, and that's a different thing for being in the tech world. Usually we argue about everything. My take on it is APIs lets you become more than what you are. The downside of that, we just heard in the Q&A for the last security session, you become more than what you are because you're letting go of control. You're letting other companies cannibalize you by taking your service, your logic, and make something new, something more with it. The upside being, you don't have to struggle to be in the forefront. You can let the others be there for you. I think that it is something that redefines your service. Agile, on the other hand, is an approach to problems. It is a software development process, but it's also a business process. And in some ways, it's a way to describe how something behaves. Agile means lean. It means being quick and nimble. It means invest a lot, be passionate, but make sure you can quickly spin it around and go somewhere else if need be. It means breaking things down, not breaking things. Now, I'm not one of those evangelists that talks about break fast. I don't want to break. I don't mind going fast, but let's not break while we do it. So let's talk about 7 misconceptions about what is Agile API. Well, the first misconception is you gotta build it yourself. You gotta do everything yourself. No one is better than you are. And this is the ultimate guy, right? Like, he's okay. We like him. We just don't want to be him. And as a matter of fact, I really want to point that out. Don't be this guy. What this means is you should focus on what you do best and make sure that your system is focused at that as well. And let everyone else do the rest for you. If we take a look at my company, again, Beepsend, I'm not going to be talking too much about it. I actually brought another guy. If you want to talk about Beepsend, then we have a second Christian. He's back there somewhere. We made it easy for you, so I named him the same. We are SMS specialists. Yeah, that's great. But we're so much more. Beepsend is really these companies. If you want to talk about what we're doing all of this. We got Google Apps because they're really pros at calendars and mail. We are not. And we don't even want to try to be. So we let them handle that for us. The little cat up there, that's where we put our source code. And it has really improved our efficiency. We use these guys to help us manage our customers, and we're trying these guys out, like them a lot. These guys, well, you know them, right? They're hosting some of our equipment, not all of it, but some of it. And Trello, beautiful little system, and Zapier. Zapier is a way for us to make money by giving some away, I guess. Now, what these all got in common is that they offer APIs to their internal logic. Our system is really these systems. That's how they make money. That's how we become pros. Now, Zapier is a little special in this case because what they do, they allow us to not have to worry so much about explaining APIs to customers. Whenever we meet a new customer, enterprises, they tend to think they're unique. you probably come across this. Our business model is kind of like them, but we're special. Now, the problem is if you believe them, because then you will start to customize your system to fit their needs. Eventually, you have a fragmented system that no one understands. And they, by that time, they have moved on because you have instabilities. So we try to use other services to link us to them. For example, Zapier. In Zapier, we expose our business logic, the API. We just try to make it sound more high-tech than what it is. And everyone else does too. And then it's up to our customers to join whatever service they're using with our service to get that working, or the other way around. It's really fancy that way. The example I use here, Pingdom. Pingdom, you might know of the service. They make sure the servers are online. And if they're not, they'll let you know. If you, they can do that in a number of different ways, one of them being as an extra premium feature, they can send you a text message. We offer text messages. So what we did here is we plug in ourselves to Zapier, so does they. And then we could say, when we have a Pingdom alert, send a message, but use our platform instead. We're cheaper, by the way. Now, you could say we're pissing Pingdom off here, right? But it's the other way around, and this is what makes API so beautiful. We are generating business customers. We're generating customers for them, traffic for them. We're strengthening their core product while focusing on ours. We also get traffic. It's a win-win. The shortcut to the cheese here that you sometimes see is as soon as a company builds, spends the time investing in that cumbersome API, they do the monumentally big step and then they want to charge for it. I think that's a little bit of a problem. And the reason is you scare customers away. You don't want to charge for the fact that you're enabling them to use your service. You want to charge them for your service. I had a beautiful meeting with a company called Podio last week, and they were really torn about this still to this day. They have great platform. It is really great. They have support for extensions. That's what they call apps within their software, so that they don't have to hire 450 developers to develop every possible nuance of their system. They open it up for others to develop it based on whatever needs they see fit, and they're not charging for it. But they are considering it, and I said don't. They don't have SMS functionality yet. Check in a few weeks, they will have it by a third-party plugin that connects their API to our API, and everyone's happy. They make more money because they have now a more full-featured platform. We make more money because we now have more customers. I don't see anyone crying. That's APIs for you. It's quite beautiful. That would be the crying. So beautiful, you shed a tear, don't you? The second misconception is if you don't have an API, if you're not agile, you're not successful. I believe this is something we're all here because we are either super fascinated by APIs or two, super scared that we're missing the boat. There is a lot of companies out there that has missed the boat, even more that has said, you know what, that boat ride is not for us. And they're not dying. They're doing pretty good. A lot of banks are doing pretty good. They have the biggest buildings in the city, usually in the center. They don't have so many APIs. As a matter of fact, they got COBOL. COBOL is not a very agile language. It's not well suited for APIs, but they still make money, they're still profitable, and they'll continue to be. The other thing that's interesting about being agile is that I think there is a relationship between being agile and how close to the end customer you are. The closer you are to the end consumer, the more agile you need to be in your approach to every problem, because end consumers, this is internet users, they're fickle and they're promiscuous. They're curious. They'll leave your service in a heartbeat. You could do everything they ask of you. They don't want to pay for it, and eventually they're going to leave you for it because something else, a new cool cat showed up in the neighborhood. So that's why you need to be super agile, being able to move around and be able to follow them and their every quirk and need. But the more distance you have to the end consumer, the more stability you want. Whenever you guys are talking to a bank, if you're sitting down in a meeting with them, the last thing they want to hear is, we're super nimble, we're agile, we're here, now we're here. Like, you can never count where we're going to be. Like, the last thing a bank wants to hear, they want to hear, man, we've been this way for 250 years and we have no intention to change. That's a deal right there. So you really need to think about, what is it we're doing? Why do we need this API? What does agile mean to us and our business model? That's what we're asking ourselves quite a lot, actually, at Beepsend. What are we trying to be? You're not automatically successful just because you're agile. You're successful if you are passionate about your core model. The third misconception, there is a software development process and it's the perfect one. XP, waterfall, agile, Scrum. The one I hear, thing I hear the most is, we're doing Scrum, but we've got a different take on it. Yeah, because everyone's special, right? Now, I think there are different software development processes because there are different needs, different problems, different situations. Try to identify what kind of developers you're working with, how many are they, and what is the problem you're trying to solve. And then look at, all right, so what methods do we see used in the wild? And how does that fit to us? A common problem is you throw tools, project management tools, at your developers because that way they will go faster. Or you want more transparency. What the hell are they doing in the IT department? Let's throw some tools to get transparency. It doesn't work that way. Tools are supposed to support your software development process, not enforce it. The fourth misconception, your system is secure. Sorry, I'm nervous, of course. I'm on a stage. You'd be too. Your system is secure. It's a beautiful misconception. I love that we had a whole block about security. It is really relevant. It's not more relevant with APIs. It's just as relevant. Now, if you have like a super... Okay, let me change that. So the problem with security and your take on security is that you think that security is about your mind and you're battling that clever hacker in China or wherever he might be. Most of them are actually in Sweden, some friends of mine. You might think that it's a battle, it's like between you and them, and you gotta outsmart them, and then you're done, you won, you're good. That's not how it works, unfortunately, because those days were fun. They were in the 90s, we're not there anymore. Now, it's a million scripts, and they never get tired. They keep running over and over. And you know what the worst part is? The guys running the scripts, they barely care about them. They barely care about you. They just want to get a pling. All right, I got another network to add to my zombie network here. Good, let's go, let's move on. Whenever you're targeted, that's a completely different thing. So let's not even go there. But for the most part, you got to win this battle every day and they never get tired. The other problem is, let's say you have a perfect system, no flaws whatsoever. You managed to do it. You locked everything down. You pulled the power cord. You're good. Well, actually, you're good. But let's say you keep the power cord in. Now you got a secure system, perfect developers, everyone's happy. Well, not likely, because most likely, chances are you have users. Now again, users are human, and human are, they fail. We know that because we've seen the sci-fi movies. Now, they got passwords. If the password is used somewhere else and that place is exposed, it doesn't matter how good your system is, you're now exposed. And if you get that, like, let's get rid of the users. You have a problem with your business model now, by the way. But anyway, let's get rid of them and let's get rid of all the flaws. You have no exploits. You have a perfect system. We're all good, right? Not quite. Heartbleed, anyone? Like when you finally got everything right, some other dude screwed it up and it affects you. And if heartbleed wasn't bad enough, four days ago now, Amazon sent out an email saying, yeah, Oracle got some issues with MySQL. Now, chances are you might use them in your system, like... you got upgrade 5.5.5.6, and they are pretty critical. So what they're doing now, even Amazon, they said, yeah, here's what's gonna happen. Next week, we're gonna push you to 5.5 or 5.6. You have no choice except upgrade before we do it for you. It's quite critical. Like, if you relax, you're screwed. And that's the reality we're in. You gotta just change your mindset. You gotta think, this is quite fun. Let's do this game. And one way of doing this game is centralized configurations. That is how you stay agile. You need to make sure that it's not a manual effort, that it's not a labor to keep your systems up to date. You gotta make sure you understand your technology, because if you don't, there are holes in it. You gotta make sure that your developers, unless you are developers, have taken active steps to prevent XSS flaws. Let me say that once again. If you have not taking steps to prevent XSS in your system, you, congratulations, you now have a system with an XSS flaw. And it is pretty bad. Oh yeah, Poodle, anyone? Just happened the other day. Terrible, isn't it? Or it pays our paychecks, right? I'm pretty stoked. Misconception 5, extensive SLAs and EULAs will save your ass. Yeah, this is also quite interesting. It's not going to happen. Like, you could go the PayPal route and write 97 pages. If you print it, it literally is 97 pages. I had another talk which is about that specifically. 97 pages. Do you think that keeps their users in line? Ooh, it's 97 pages of legal stuff. I better not do anything wrong. It doesn't work that way. And the SLAs, you gotta have 99.9999% uptime. It's not like I'm trying to break my systems, it just happens. And when it does, I'm working my best to prevent it. These things will only do one thing for your company, or your APIs in this case. It's gonna make sure that people get afraid of you. You become like Eric Ries, the lean startup, is that the Imview? He had the best EULA ever. I mean, it's also the biggest failure on the internet, but it made him successful. His EULA said, don't be the creepy guy. Accept, check, continue. I mean, it's really that simple, right? Because if you are the creepy guy, if you abuse the EULAs, what are you as a company going to do? Are you going to chase that guy down in the other country and you're going to bring him to court and finally 9 months later, this is settled and you can celebrate? Now you don't have a problem anymore? Sorry, you had a problem 9 months ago and you just lost 9 months. Try and invite people instead of scare them away. Our EULAs are pretty long as well, but I'm doing this talk internally at Beepsend as well. This is not the first time. It takes time to change this mindset. The sixth being, your API is special, keep the secret secret. Yeah, now again, I'm not preaching the truth here, it just happens to be that way. So when we saw this the talk earlier, which said, yeah, this is a slide, I've taken the confidential parts out. Like, that's not the way to approach technology. Come on, let's be verbose about it. If your secret really is that no one has figured out what technology you use, you're screwed, you're doomed, you're beyond saving. Your secret must be your staff, your DNA, your culture, your business model, your agility, your ability to change. Your ears to listen to the customers, to understand changes. DNA, not technology. Technology supports your employees to help them become great, do great, to help your company become great. That's the secret. The secret might be how much you pay them, I don't know, but it's not the technology. Hell, turn around. I'd say, let's show people what kind of technology you use, how you solve problems, let's help out. And the more secret you are, chances are you're actually the loneliest guy on the island when shit starts to break. And I think this is awesome. Tropicana, if you look every box in the store, like, I don't really know what defines a secret, but I think this pretty much breaks it, right? The secret behind Tropicana, it's on every box. If you want to learn the secret, just go to the supermarket. Now, I'm going to hurry up a little bit because I don't have so much time left. Seventh being, NoSQL is the future of all APIs. I'm sure you've heard of NoSQL, right? It's the new kid on the block and it's awesome. Now, it is awesome. It's just not the most awesomest thing ever. Sliced bread is. NoSQL solves a lot of problems. But it doesn't solve all of them. My experience is that the best implementation of a NoSQL in a computer system or a software system is when it's in combination with a relational database and preferably a key value store as well. Like, put some Redis in there, a Memcache, just to spice things up. That's how you make the most out of NoSQL. Solve, look at the problem and use the appropriate solution for it. Now, if you're one of these guys that says NoSQL fixes everything, I don't mind having a beer with you, but let's talk about something else while we do, because this is a pointless moot discussion. I love NoSQL, but it's not the savior of mankind, and it doesn't make your RESTful API any more RESTful. All right, so that was a little bit about the agile business. I wasn't really supposed to talk about that, right, Travis? But I did anyways, because I think it's so much fun. I was supposed to talk about tech. Travis told me, well, are you guys using Node? Like, talk Node. Node is freaking agile. That's great. And I'm like, So I said, we don't use Node anymore, but we threw it out. And then I'm like, he's onto something. There is actually some things about technology that does apply to what is an agile API. Now, let's look at five of them. First being, computers are awesome at doing pretty much everything. I think we can all agree on that. That's why we're in this room today. There are, however, three things they're not very good at. If you silently, quietly, you can guess for yourself. The first one, of course, being division. Like, computers are not very good at math, ironically enough. There's a second thing they're not very good at, once we got that out of the window. Time and dates, they're not very good at handling that. It's an invention of us, ours, and we don't even know how to handle it. Like, skottor, anyone? I don't even know what that is called, but it's terrible. This is not very easy for computers. The Millennium Bug, you remember that? Third being characters. Computers are really bad at handling text. So when you think about it, you put these three together. This is kind of why we invented a computer, isn't it? And it's been like 100 years. We managed to do everything but these three things with computers. Now that's irony for you. And if you're actually building an API and you happen to use a transactional database, such as like MySQL, here's a bonus tip for you. Integers are finite, like they end. They are not very good for primary key that is auto-incrementing. A fun thing, Google the Twitpocalypse. It's actually Twitter that alerted everyone using their APIs, like, here's what's going to happen. 5 days from now, we're going to run out of integers. We're going to double the bit size of it. That might break your applications. And it was beautiful to watch that shit happen, because it was like a train wreck in slow motion when internet just went down. Don't do that. You can read for yourself, because I'm out of time. This one is actually, do you mind if I just... Yeah, we've already covered a little bit. Your API is really your documentation. You were talking about it like, we use RAML first. We didn't even program. First, document that shit. Couldn't set it better myself. Actually, I'm not even going to try to. RAML. There you go. It's awesome. And if you want to be a little cooler, if you want to be a little more like, yeah, we use the latest technology, of course you go with Swagger. It's kind of the same thing. It's just more fancy. We did it this way. We looked at a company called Stripe. We think they're awesome, and we copied them right off the bat. Good artists copy, great artists steal. This is how we do it. API, super easy. This is how stuff is, and this is how you code it, and everyone is happy. Like, the better this is, the easier it is to use our APIs. And isn't that why we're all here? If you don't have one API, because then, of course, you're here because you want to build one. And then we got high availability, load balancers, low coupling, high cohesion, which, if you're an object-oriented programmer, you know what that means. If you're not, you should really look into that, because it applies to everything. And finally, test beds. Use proper test beds and use continuous integration, but don't get them mixed around. You want the test bed there first. Otherwise, you don't have much use of the CI. Thank you very much for your time.
All right.